Good morning again. Nice to meet you. It's actually an honor to have this opportunity of talking and changing ideas with such experienced women. So, Yulia, I would start by asking you like a description of what has been the role of women in Ukraine, especially in these last 2 years.
Thank you. Thank you, first of all, for the invitation. And thank you for raising this important issue. And maybe I would have a chance to show you a small presentation, just we'll give you a few numbers. Actually, the stories of women in Ukraine is stories both of the strengths and pain. And actually, I would give you a few numbers just for understanding that in Ukraine, we're still suffering a lot, and we've got these losses. And if anyone thinks that the level of Russian brutality is decreasing, it's not. I just will give you a few numbers. The latest UN High Commissioner report showed that from July to October of this year, the number of civilian casualties was 45% higher than the previous period. July 2024 actually is a dateless month for civilians in Ukraine. And since start of the large-scale invasion, 18,000 civilians was claimed like a violence, war-related violence. However, the true numbers of civilian victims might be much more higher because we are not having the accurate numbers of the civilians that have been suffered and during the first days of large-scale invasion, for example, in Mariupol. So the horrific numbers are growing every day. But beyond these figures, there are some other figures that actually killing me personally from inside. And one of such crimes is conflict-related sexual violence. So according to the data from our prosecutor office, there were 321 causes of such violence with survivors. Age of them were ranging from 4 years old till 82 year old. However, US estimates that this number can be much more higher. And for me, it's very, very, very horrifying to comprehend that the younger Ukrainian who suffered from such violence were like a girl of 4 years old. So in any occupied cities, rape is used by Russian as a tactic to intimidate pro-Ukrainian people. And the latest figures are also horrifying me, like a minister of economy, because we have 4.4 million Ukrainians that forced to leave the country. And of course, we are looking for the incentives, how to find incentives, how to return them back home. And so 4.26 million Ukrainians, they have been registered as internally displaced people, and about 60% of them are women that have high education, that have kids, that are not able to return back because of the war in Ukraine. But going through the difficulties facing with the war, Ukrainian women are showing incredible resilience. And they are becoming leaders in different situations. They are leading communities, they are leading the government, they are leading businesses, and actually Ukrainian women find a way how to transform their pain into strength. So that's why I have a small present to my colleague. We just discussed it before this panel. So actually, it's a scarf made by women who have been suffering from violence, but she, together with our partners from UNFPA, so this is a project. So they're trying to transform their pain in something crucial. And this is the name. So she writes on that it's a dobrota, kindness. So that's why it's also we're also trying to find a way how to transform their pain in something that might be vital for you. So it's for you. It's kind of symbol as well, and I hope that it would be a kind of example for other women how we can support, how we can help them to transform.
So let me just say, it's truly, it's truly what we usually read but cannot see by materializing from an adversity, trying to make it an opportunity, and also passing a message that strength is fundamental, resilience is crucial to keep going.
It's crucial to keep going, and I would say that resilience of Ukrainian women is synonym of resilience of Ukraine. And if you look at the number, we have 62,000 women that now in the army. And if you look at the numbers of the economic growth, and if you look at the numbers of the women that founded their business, so it's more than 56% of Ukrainian business have been founded by the women by the last year. And women are incredibly interested in their chosen profession that previously we called like mostly like profession for men. So now we have courses how to drive excavators, how to drive trucks, how to be mine detectors for women. So that's why Ukrainian resilience, it's resilience of Ukrainian women. And of course, we also see the trend that Ukrainian women now lead their own businesses, families, businesses. And for me, well, for many women, we need, like a government, to focus on several areas, how to provide them opportunities to transform, as you say, their pain in their strengths. Of course, it's legislative changes, because Ukraine still live based on the labor court of Soviet Union time. So now we are working on the new labor code, and I hope that we would be able to pass it through our parliament during the next year. But it will be crucial, because we will give the opportunity to work from home, to have to be able to simultaneously work in different places, and to combine it. And in the new labor code, we need to remove some old and outdated norms. For example, today, women that have children under 3 years old are not able to go on business trip. So it's something very strange, and it's something that should be changed in the new legislature, because we need to have a flexibility for women to be actively involved in labor life. Also, we are create several business programs, both led by the government and by our partners. The idea that women that want to set up businesses need to have a very easy way how to do it. So we're providing granting programs for them, and by the last 2.5 years, so we have provided 20,000 grants for Ukrainians willing to start this business. And of course, we have started this training programs, and nearly 50 countries, they joined over this idea to train women in Ukraine. And we hope that it will help 180,000 Ukrainians to get new skills and new courses. Of course, we are creating conditions of those Ukrainian women who wish to return home, so they can start their business, they can bring and
the
make their contribution to Ukrainian economy. Because I have not shared these numbers, but when the large-scale invasion have started, our GDP has fallen up to 30%. Mm-hmm. Last year, we grew 5%. This year, 3.5. So that's why I think it's good results, and we keep going and keep reviving our economy. And of course, we are also, despite of the fact of war, we're looking at the gender salary gap. Now in Ukraine, it's 18%. Yes, in Portugal, if I'm not mistaken, so it's at around 13%. So that's why we set up for us this goal to decrease this difference, and we want to, in 10 years to decrease it, also to have the same, I would say, the same figures like Portugal has. So that's why under the leadership of Elena Zelenska that had her speech previously, so we set up a program, so it calls in Ukrainian, "Zvisno zmozhesh." In English, it's "Of course you can," and campaign. So, and now I'd like to give you a short video on the some few examples of women that show their strengths and resilience. So, if you don't mind, just very small.
Okay, let's see the video.
Zvisno Я постійно чула, що повинна знайти роботу, що пасує жінці.
Це не твоє. Навіщо ризикувати життям як чоловік, а заробляти як жінка?
У дитинстві мені казали, що моє тіло не підходить для цього спорту, і дівчата тут пристойно не заробляють. Але я буду наполегливо працювати, бо мене оточують люди, що вірять в мене.
Я покладатиму стани і віритиму в себе.
Я мушу рухатись вперед.
Привіт, дуже рада всіх бачити.
Зможу підкорити нові висоти.
І мене нічого не зупинить.
So the women, the strength of our country lies in the strength of our women. It's not my world. This world belongs to Indira Gandhi, but I truly believe that it's really so. On this, on the latest slide, you might see a lady standing with me. Her name is Natalia. She's from Pokrovsk. It's Donetsk region. It's very close to the front line. And she is leading the business there, steel manufacturing business, and she took some like granting money from the government to be able to develop it. And she said that I want to be an example for my children of how to stand firm where other might break. And for me, it's a real example of resilience. So this woman that are going through hell because of the war, that are making these scarves, actually, this woman firmly hold Europeans' peace, and they hold this Europeans' peace under their protection. Mm-hmm. So for me, Ukrainian women are real a hero, like our guys at the front line. So I'm a big advocate for women in Ukraine, and that's why we're so focused on the peace formula. That's why we're so focused on joining other countries over this idea to get lasting peace for Ukraine. Thank you.
And you have a lot of reasons to be very proud of Ukrainian women. Well, Senida, you look even prettier now with your new scarf. So why are women essential in peace building in nations, but also for continents, for the world?
This scarf reminds me of a saying that says that in a world that you can be everything, please be kind. So many thanks for this gift. It has a really meaning. Oh my God, the question, why do we need women? Do you allow me to make a question to the audience?
Of course.
Then the question is for every you. Raise the hand, the one that born are and feel like women and girls. To all the girls there, just raise a hand. I see more, but no hands. And then with the hands up, the one that supports the work and the life and the happiness the women bring in their lives. Can you raise the hands?
Yes.
Yes? Yeah, of course. So that's why we need women everywhere. Women are part of our life. It's the other half, basically. So why not in conflict resolution and in peace resolution, we don't have women involved. Madam Deputy Prime Minister shows us the economy of war. What does it mean to live in a place where men are forced to go to war, are forced to preserve their nation, their freedom? The rest, it's the job of a woman. Not simply raising children, educating them, taking care of the healthcare issues. But yes, they need to work in agriculture, they need to work in heavy industry, because at the end of the day, they need to raise up the families. And I'm come from a generation, I was a teenager in my country, and I'm happy here to represent two continents, basically. I'm from Albania, and I born and raised up in a communist regime till 90s, so I was a teenager when the system shift. And then you know, when a system shift, it has turmoils, it has conflicts, and definitely it it has civil wars. Then in 97, we had another civil war because of a pyramidal system crashed. So Albanians lost a lot of money into investing in some pyramidal schemes. And then people, because they're losing everything, went on the street. So I was raised in the sense of, I was raised good because of my parents, one in heaven and one in this earth still with us. But I was raised with their fear in their eyes. Don't talk. Don't sing foreign languages, don't listen to foreign languages, to foreign TV stations, and so on and so forth, because they hear us, because, we can go to jail. So this kind of impeding us to flee maybe made us a little bit much more stronger as a female in Albania, because we want to grasp everything that our parents or our grandmothers and the mothers didn't have the opportunity to. At the same time, I'm presenting here the UPF, Universal Peace Federation, which was founded by a marvelous woman born in North Korea, persecuted by that regime there, imprisoned, forced to flee out of her country. Her followers called her Mother Moon, but she's she's a woman which all these services experience didn't stop her to do whatever she is doing now, to promote peace around the world and to try to reconcile as much as possible the North and South Korea. So these are examples that shape our life. My question now is, what legacy are we giving to the next generation? We, as women, together with our partners, men, how we are working together for a peaceful, more inclusive, and definitely much more growth, resilience, and equity. So I do believe that the role of women is very much important, because at the end of the day, they are suffering for whatever is happening in a conflict. Studies have proven and shown that when women are an integral part of the peace resolution, so, I want to start with the conflict resolution first, because that is much important. It cares too much, but it's costly, it has much less cost into preventing a war rather than entering in a war and then try to find a peace resolution. It proves that it has 20-30% chances more if women are included in conflict resolution to prove much more successful, and up to 40% more as an agreement which can last up to 10-15 years if women are part of the negotiation in the conflict resolution. Why? Because women think in terms of family, they think in terms of future generation, they put much more empathy in terms of the discussion and trying to find a consensus between parties. Not that men are not able to, but still the prideness of a man and the haters that probably is in that moment probably impede them to see a little bit the future and the economic development. Mm-hmm. Women bring another perspective. That's why I started this discussion to see, okay, here in this audience, more women are than men. And then it's a part of our life to work and to co-live with two genders. So why not in the peace reconciliation phases, or better, preventing a conflict, women should not be part of this, of this process. Mm-hmm. There is a good example of what women in Burundi are doing, where the conflicts between different groups are happening. They have been part of, I think, 5,000 more of conflict resolution processes. So this is proving that, yes, women can do better, but they can do everything. So I'm not saying who is doing better and who is much more important. Each of us in our life has its own roles, but I do believe that it's more resilient when women are part of the processes, because at the end of the day, they are the one who are suffering all the costs of a war or of a conflict. Mm-hmm. So definitely it's better that we involve them in terms of negotiation. I saw by myself in politics in Albania, it was too harsh in 19th, and basically 99.9% were men involved in politics. The language was much more harsh. The debate, the public debate was, oh my God, you needed to change the TV because
the
you couldn't
hear.
Or if you see...
We are rushing out of time.
Or in the parliament, they were literally start fighting with each other. Now that more than 35-40% are women, even in the parliament, the language, it's much more, let's say, better.
And definitely we hear much more each other. And when you hear much more each other, then definitely we will try to find the solution. It's a win-win for both of the occasions.
Yulia and Senida, it was very good to listen to you. We just don't have no more time for your sharings and envisions, but the message that you brought here was the most important. Thank
May
you.
May I say just a small sentence?
Well, very,
just very,
very small.
Short. I just want to give my appreciation to all the women that at the end of the day are enriching our lives and shaping our future. So thank you.
Thank you too.